Good evening, everyone. Terrific to have you here for this concert titled Fantastique. For those of you who are joining us live streaming on the web, great to have you sort of here. And for those of you who then watch this concert on YouTube later on, we're really glad you're here. We're going to begin with an overture by Mozart. This is an overture to his opera, which has translated is The Abduction from the Seraglio. A seraglio is essentially a harem, usually in the Turkish areas. And that's why there are special instruments, exotic instruments, that are being used for this particular overture. They include bass drum, cymbals, and triangle. But you need to understand, in the late 18th century, these were wild and crazy exotic instruments from far off Turkey. The form for this particular overture starts with a fast beginning. There's a middle section that's a little bit slower, and the beginning returns. We call it an ABA form. Please enjoy this overture by Mozart to The Abduction from the Seraglio.
Thank you.
As the director of instrumental music here at Franklin and Marshall College, I have a unique opportunity because my conducting world lives both in the wind ensemble world and also the orchestral world. So last night the Symphonic Wind Ensemble performed, and what was really interesting about their presentation is what it means to have repertoire for a group like the Wind Ensemble, which is about 100 years old. So for the most part, they're performing music that's always by 20th and 21st century composers. A lot of them are still alive. Now we come to this evening, and we come to the orchestra, where almost all of our composers are dead. And we have to work hard in this case to have music by living composers. So a wonderful dichotomy between those two worlds. So this next piece fits the category of doing a piece by a living composer, Joseph Carrel. The work is inspired by the outdoors, Wyoming. It begins with a prayer presented by the low brass and low winds, and then it moves through some sort of ethereal sections. You just have a sense of the great blue sky. Moves into the middle section, which features an amazing trumpet solo that Kate will be presenting. And that then becomes the established melodic material that will take us through the rest of the work with a triumphant ending. So this is perhaps a premiere for you because this is a work that you may not be familiar with. So have your ears open, your eyes open, and your hearts open as this drama unfolds for you. This is Wind River by Joseph Carrel. Before we present the second half, I'd like to take an opportunity to celebrate our graduating seniors. Something that I believe in very strongly is that each person who is part of an organization is just as important as each other. So for that reason, I need you to enthusiastically cheer for each one of these folks. I'm going to begin with two people who are not Franklin or Marshall students, who are either graduating or moving on to their next destination. So the first person, when they started playing in the FNM Orchestra, they were literally shorter than their cello. Graduating from Conestoga Valley High School, Alex Markley. He's now taller than his cello. Person I'm going to miss a great deal, holding down the fort in the trombone section, moving on to the University of North Carolina for graduate work, Grayson Norcross. Our next senior is not listed in the program. There's a reason. We had a musical emergency. One of our performers was ill, could not perform tonight. On literally no notice, sight reading the part, playing amazingly in percussion, Mary Xiang. We were backstage marveling at what she accomplished tonight. That was really stunning. In percussion, Marshall Dugan. On tuba, Nick Loffman. On horn, Sarah Leach. On horn, Brittany Saunders. On trumpet, Dan Grossman. On clarinet, Zixin Zeng. On oboe, Gwen Fowler. On flute, Eric Norford. On flute, Hannah Kowalski. On flute, Ming Bauer. Our next senior is in the bass section, but he is injured his shoulder, is not able to perform, and I don't think he's even able to be here. It's Kyle Snyder. Let's give him a cheer. On cello, Victoria Kwok. On viola, Ariel Labiner. On viola, Allie Campbell. On violin, Kaylin Nappy. And our co-concertmaster, Michelle Pond. Have I missed any seniors? Please excuse me, I need to talk to my seniors.
Panels
Don't fool with the low brass. Symphony Fantastique by Berlioz. So there's a story behind this. The story is not terrific. I'm really sorry about this. I'm just reporting. So Berlioz went to a play. It was a Shakespeare play. And he just became enchanted with the lead actress and fell in love with her sitting in the audience. He started to write love letters to her. Shock of all shocks, she did not respond. He was very disappointed by this. So he decided to write a symphony about his lost love, whom he had never met. So the premiere took place. She was invited to come. She did not. But she heard about it. And so they met. They got married, which was a terrible idea because they went very, very badly. And they had to separate. So the music that you're about to experience is all about this lost love. And here's the story. Supposedly there's an artist, that would be Berlioz, who had this lost love who he couldn't connect with. So the first movement is all about that passion. Now, in the movement, there's a particular theme that is the love theme. It is the theme for the person for whom the artist is enchanted with. It's called the idée fixe because it's going to appear in every single movement, and many of the movements are based upon this particular melody. So after you get through a pretty extensive introduction full of passion, you're going to hear the initial idée fixe presented by the violins and flute. And you'll say, aha, there it is. So the first movement is about that passion. The second movement, our artist has gone to a ball, but everywhere he looks, he just sees visions of his love that he hasn't had a chance to meet yet. So it's a very disturbing movement for him, even though it's a beautiful ball. In the ball, you will hear the idée fixe. Then he goes out into nature to clear his mind, but everything he sees reminds him of his love that he hasn't connected with. He'll hear a distant hornpipe. It's just bringing so much sorrow to him. So the fourth movement, this is where things get a little bit dicey. So the reports are, according to Berlioz, he had a little opium when he was writing this, and he wrote it in a day. I don't know. But the artist in the story is supposed to have gone into an opium-induced dream. And in this dream, he has apparently killed his lover, whom he never met. And this is the march to the scaffold, the march to his execution. And he's looking down on seeing this entire thing taking place. Again, I'm just reporting. The fifth movement is the Witch's Sabbath. This is where everyone, monsters and other creatures, hellish type folk, are really thrilled that the artist is dead. And he's being welcomed into this hellish extravaganza, and he's totally terrorized, and one of the monsters happens to be, yes, you guessed it, his lover that he never met. And you'll hear that with the idée fixe. Meanwhile, we will then hear the Dies Irae, which is the death mass chant. And that then becomes relatively triumphant at the end, because finally all of this stuff has come to a close. Again, I'm just reporting. This piece changed everything from a symphonic compositional standpoint. The idea of having such an elaborate story that could be connected with a symphony was unheard of. This eventually led to the creation of tone poems that were major symphonic works that, in fact, were designed to tell stories. So it's Berlioz who is bulldozing through music history and creating a whole new concept. So we're going to get tuned and present for you the Symphonie Fantastique by Berlioz.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.